important meal of the day. But we are here in the church, so we want to start with prayer. So let's just bow our heads as we pray to our Heavenly Father. Daddy, we bless and we glorify your holy name. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for giving us once again the gift of another day. We thank you for lending us your breath of life for this new day. We thank you for renewing your mercy this morning. We thank you for many months of planning has resulted in this day. We thank you for bringing each and every one of us here. We thank you for the table that has been laid before us. We thank you for all things. Daddy, we just want to pray that this will be the beginning of great things to come in the mighty name of Jesus. So, Father, as we dine with you now, we ask that you come and join us, and we bless the food in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit, to your glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Please feel free. Let's not be shy. There's no women here. Eat to your fill. Let's have a good breakfast. All right? And then we'll come back in about 20 minutes, 20 to 25 minutes to have the session. All right?
I'm the center of it all. It's you that I see. It's you that I see. I'm the center of it all. It's you that I see. It's you that I see. There is power in your name. Miracles happen in your name. I salute a voice in praise. It's you that I see. It's you that I see. Sing it out. Say.
I'm the center of it all.
It's you that I see.
It's you that I see.
Jesus only.
It's you that I see.
Lift those hands wherever you are. At the center.
At the center of
it all. It's you that I see. Only you, Jesus. Lift those hands up. There is power.
There is power in your name.
Miracles happen.
Miracles happen
in your name. I still lift a voice.
I still lift a voice of praise.
You that I see. One more time, sing with us. Sing. At the center.
At the center of it all.
Yeah.
It's you that I see.
Jesus.
It's you that I see.
Nobody else is worthy. At the center of
it. At the center of it all.
Only you.
It's you that I see.
Hands wherever you are, declaring there is power.
There is power.
Strongest, you are higher, higher than the highest. You the center of it all is you that I see. It's you that I see. Oh, at the center of it all is you that I see. It's you that I see. Thank you for your miracles, Lord.
Holy is the Lord God Almighty. The whole earth is filled with his goodness. He is holy. He is high. He is set apart. So we sing to him.
Almighty God, I bless your name. Holy One, I worship you, for you are God all by yourself. You are God all by yourself. Age to age, you're still the same. All creation will shout your name, for you are God all by yourself. Oh God, you are God all by yourself. I bless your name, oh God, for who you are. I worship you, for you are God all by yourself. Oh God, you're God all by yourself.
Like you, none compares to you.
You are God all by yourself.
Lift those hands wherever you are, declaring, age to age,
age to age.
Oh Lord,
you're still the same.
All of creation,
all creation,
woo!
Shout your name.
The Israel Institute of Biblical Studies is a prestigious academy for the study of biblical languages, culture, and history, which is partnered with the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. Our school's method unique.
All right, guys.
To you, everything.
withholding nothing, withholding nothing. Lord, I surrender all to you. Back on God, but there's a people who are crying out and saying, all I want.
not after the blessings, I'm not after the things, I'm after the presence of God. All I want. Because when you get God, you get everything else that you need. All I want is you, Lord. You can seek after things but miss God, but if you seek after God, the things will come. All I want. All I want. Every encounter with God changes Withholding nothing.
Withholding nothing. Withholding nothing. Withholding nothing.
Praise God. Oh my God. It's a good thing I wore a waistcoat so you can't see what's underneath. You know, yesterday I had planned to fast yesterday so that in preparation for this breakfast meeting. I know those spiritual people there are thinking, is this guy very spiritual? He's fasting for the meeting to go. So I said, no. I was fasting so that I would have enough space to have breakfast this morning. Unfortunately, my wife, with her list of things to do, by 10 o'clock, I found myself in a bowl of granola. And that was the end of the fast. But I've had a wonderful breakfast. We thank God. And we thank God for the hands that have made it and pray that the Lord blesses them. We're going to kick off, and please feel free to keep eating and feel free to get up at any time to help yourself to whatever's at the table. But we're going to start now. Our topic for this session, it's the first breakfast meeting we've had in probably 3 years. The last one was in 2015, if I'm not mistaken, so it's 4 years now. But the title of this is, Am I on track? Am I on track? Now, when you hear a question like that, it's quick to jump to conclusions. But am I on track could mean different things to different people. Jeremiah chapter 1, verse 5 tells us that God himself said, before I formed you, I knew you. Before I called you, I sanctified you and ordained you to be a prophet. So every one of us has a plan in our life. Proverbs chapter 19, verse 21 tells us that many are the plans in the heart of a man, but the Lord's counsel is the only one that will stand. Which means that for each and every person that is born into the world or that is created, there's a plan for you And I. Now, when you hear the question, am I on track? It might be that you don't even know what your plan is. So am I on track for you might be, what is God's plan for my life? And we'll hope to address that today. For the fortunate ones that have discovered God's plan for them, am I on track could mean answering the question, do I have a plan to achieve God's plan in my life? So do I have a plan for God's plan? How am I going to achieve it? Does, if God is saying, I want you to preach all over the world, do you have a plan to learn languages? Do you have a plan to get the visas that you need? Do you have a plan to get your paperwork in place to go around the world? And then, am I on track? If you've crossed the first bridge, you've crossed the second bridge, you know the plan, you have a plan for a plan. You cannot know if you're on track if you do not track it, if you don't monitor it. So the third thing we're going to address is, how do I ensure that I remain on track, or I'm still on track? So we'll try, our speaker today would, by God's grace, and I believe that God has spoken to him, would touch on these three areas. On these three areas. We'll see how it goes. It might be that there might be a full-on session, or he might be able to deal with it as the Lord helps him in this one session. But whatever it is, I believe that this will be the start of greater things to come in Jesus' name. Our speaker today is Pastor Ian McDonald. He's the senior pastor at Holy Trinity. And his passion is to see people love God. And in this local parish, we know that there's been a theme that's been coming and reoccurring since November about love. Love for God, love for each other. Our PRO that we follow as kingdom men, the key one, the middle one is relationship. Remember, relationship with God, relationship with our family, relationship with our brethren. Before Ian comes up, I want us to sing a hymn, and we will just honor God and rise to our feet as we sing this hymn. There's nothing wrong with sitting down and singing the hymn, but let's just give God honor because he's here with us. And is my hope is built on nothing else. Because, as I said in Proverbs chapter 19, verse 21, many are the plans in the man's heart, but the counsel of the Lord is the only one that will stand. So our hope must be in God. Let's sing 1, 2, go. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus Christ, my righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all over ground sinking sand. All over ground sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. His oath, his covenant, his blood support me in the whelming flood. When all around my soul gives way, He then is all my hope and stay. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found. In him righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Daddy, you are all our hope. You are all. We thank you for being here with us this morning. We ask that you speak to us, speak through Ian. Touch our hearts with the words that you've sent, and let there be a transforming of our mind and a renewing of our hearts in Jesus' name. Amen. Please take your seat. So Ian will come up now and he will speak to us for about 45 minutes. If you have any questions, please take them down and then we'll ask them at the end so that we can have a free flow. So let's just welcome Ian as he brings God.
Good morning. Praise the Lord. It's just so good to be with you. When I walked into this room, I thought I was at a wedding. Yeah, I mean, we don't do this for the men in our church. We don't get wedding bows on the chairs. But I want to do it now that I've seen it. So maybe it is a little bit of a wedding. We've just had a feast together, and it's just not. I'm not wearing wedding clothes. Jesus spoke about that, didn't he? Get some wedding clothes. Don't be found in the wrong clothes, but clothed. We just sang it. Just clothed in righteousness. Divine. He clothes you when you come to Jesus, and he just clothes you with his goodness, his righteousness. You've got new robes to wear. Amen. God has clothed you. It's so wonderful. Well, my name's Ian McDonald, and yes, I'm pastor at Holy Trinity Church. I've been there for 14 years and been blessed. I was the associate pastor, then I became the senior pastor. What a blessing. I have a lovely wife, Colleen. I've got two small children. 5 and 7, they are a handful. We were having a chat about that this morning. They're always asking questions. They are asking questions all the time. Daddy, why is this? Daddy, what are you doing this for? Daddy, what are you? Just constant questions. But the questions are good. The questions are good. And I remember when my wee boy was just 2 or 3, and he came up to me, and we were listening to the radio. And he came up to me and says, Daddy, how small are the men in the radio? And I had a choice at that moment. What am I going to do here? And I went, son, they're about that small. It's too much of a temptation. But if you've got kids, yeah, they say that parents receive more questions in a day than teachers, doctors, and lawyers put together. If you've got a 5-year-old daughter, it averages 390 questions a day on average. 390, it sends you around the wall. 390 questions a day. So my daughter's just about 6, praise God. She's just going to turn 6. Hopefully she stops asking me questions. But sometimes people ask me, how do you prepare your talks? How do you prepare your sermons? How I've been preaching the Word of God for 20 years every week, almost every week, for 20 years. How do you keep that fresh? How do you do that? And I think the first thing is that I've kept a childlike curiosity. I've kept this questioning, what does that mean? What does the Word of God mean? What does God have for me? What does this mean for me? What is God saying to me? I've constantly been asking those questions, and I'm not afraid to ask those questions of God. God, what do you have for me? What's your plan for my life? What should I do next? And I've kept asking the question. Don't be afraid. Just keep asking God the question. And maintain that childlike curiosity. I want to know. There's two types of Christians. One type of Christian says, when they don't understand something in the Bible, they go, well, we'll find out when we get to heaven. That's not me. I can't stand that. I'm like, Lord, I want to know now. Lord, I want to know what you have for me right now. I want to know what this means. If I'm confused about something, God, I want your revelation right now in my life. That's what I'm longing for. That's what I am hungry for. And today we're thinking about how do I stay on track. So I've got a couple of verses of scripture. They're probably well known to you. They're beautiful words. They're in Hebrews chapter 12. So you can turn on your Bibles if you want. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Amen. Father God, I pray that your word would truly be that lamp for our feet, light for our path. We thank you, Lord, that your word speaks directly into our lives and into the things that we're going through as men today. You have a plan and a purpose for us. Lord, reveal it through your word today by the power of the Holy Spirit. And we pray that the speaker would decrease so that Jesus Christ of Nazareth would increase. For we ask it in his holy name. Amen. Amen. We're going to do a little exercise. I'm going to set you to work. You've been eating, so you've got plenty of energy. And on your table, there's just a piece of paper with those verses on it. Those verses are there. And this is an exercise I do with guys who are wanting to preach. They want to learn how to preach. And so what I say to them, we take a passage of scripture or a few verses, and I say, right, I want you to write down every possible question you can think of about that passage. I want you to, no matter how simple it is, no matter even if you know the answer, to write down that question just really quick. Just all the questions you can think about this in this particular passage. You know, who is this? Who are these witnesses? Or whatever the question. And you're just going to write them all down. The only rule is you are not allowed in your little tables to answer the question. You are not allowed to answer the question. If anybody tries to answer the question, they have to stand up on a chair and sing God Save the Queen or something like that, okay? So I'm going to give you just a couple of minutes. Just somebody, choose somebody in your group just to read those verses in bold again. Just read them. They're just what I've read just now. And then I just want you to write down every question you can think of, no matter how simple that you think it is. Off you go. Okay, one more minute. Okay. Don't worry, it's not a competition. I'm just going to, just for the sake of time, I'll just go to a table and I'll just ask you to just say one of the questions that you wrote down. We'll start right here, the holiest table. Better be a good question. Okay, no matter how simple, simple is good. Okay. Okay, what are the sin that so easily entangles us? Excellent question. Okay, this table, do you have a... Yes, how do I run the race? How do I run the race? Yes, how do I know it is the right one? Am I on the right track? Am I on the right race? Am I running? Or am I running for myself? Brilliant. Okay, what about this table over here? Yes, how does Jesus pioneer... That's a good word there, interesting word. Pioneer and perfect our faith. That's amazing. That's amazing. You've got your hand up. Do you want to do a question? Yeah. Okay, this table. Who are this great cloud of witnesses? Okay, brilliant question. Yeah. Who determines the race? What a great question. These are amazing. I'm hopefully going to cover some of these questions this morning as we just go through. Just really simple. Just being willing to ask the questions, therefore, since whenever there's a therefore, you know this, I was taught this right from the start of my Christian faith. Whenever there's a therefore, it's there for a reason. It's there for a reason. What is it talking about? It's talking about whatever has gone on before. And the context here is Hebrews 12, is Hebrews 11, which is the great hall of faith. You've heard of the great hall of faith, haven't you? You've heard of the hall of fame, but in Hebrews 11, it's the hall of faith, of men and women who demonstrated great faith in the living God and walked that walk with him. And they find their names written, all these, David and Samson and Samuel and Moses and Elijah. And we could, the list could go on of faithful men and women. And so it's saying, because of all these people, therefore we are surrounded by this great cloud of witness. We're surrounded by them. What does it mean that we're surrounded? Surrounded by this great cloud of witnesses. I had this picture. I was taught the faith by my grandmother. My parents didn't come to faith in Jesus Christ till I was 8-9 years old. And my mum was miraculously converted. Damascus Road, had never been in a church before, walked into a church on a Thursday night, never been in a church before, was converted that night, came to know Jesus. Her life was changed. Up to that point, the only person I knew who was a Christian was my grandmother. And she taught me the faith, even though I hadn't come to faith in Jesus for myself. She's now in glory now. And I remember when she was taken up into glory, I would read these verses, and the first thought I would have was, wow, she's watching me now, and she's watching. This is what I had in my mind. She's watching over me, and she's watching my life, and she's a witness. She was my witness, and she's there. And then I started to think about that a little bit more, and thought, wait a minute, is she watching me the whole time? Is she watching everything I do, like everything? And as a teenage boy, I started to think, this is not a good thing. This is not great. Is there a great cloud of witnesses? Are they watching? But there's two types of witnesses. There's a witness. I'm witnessing you right now. I can see you. You're witnessing me speaking right now. So there's that witness. But there's also a witness in a court. And the witness in the court. Anybody here been in court? You don't have to be honest. Maybe for different reasons, and but maybe have you been called as a witness? And what you have to do is stand up and say what you've seen and what you've heard. That's the witness. That is the witness that is being spoken about here. It's not that they are all looking at you, thinking, "What a mess you're making of things. You are rubbish. You are not getting on well." They are witnessing. They are not witnesses of you. They are witnesses to you. They are a great cloud of witnesses saying, we have run the race. We have lived for the Lord Jesus. We have been through persecution and hardship and suffering, and we made it out the other side. We've been through successes. We saw great miracles. We saw God working, and we made it out the other side. We made it all the way into glory, and right now we are witnessing to you, and you are surrounded by this. You are surrounded because you have the Word of God. When you've got the Word of God, you are surrounded by witnesses to the faith. They're not witnesses of you. Don't get freaked out. Only God sees everything. God sees all. They are witnesses to you. Let me ask you the question. Who asked the question, why is it a great cloud of witnesses and not a great crowd of witnesses? Anybody write that question down? It's interesting. It doesn't say a great crowd. Why a cloud of those of you who are under 20, who's under 25 here? Is anyone under 25, under 30? You know? The cloud means something totally different than what it means to me. Okay. The cloud. My computer is constantly telling me upload to the cloud. You get some. Upload to the cloud. If I uploaded all my sermons, I need to do this. If I uploaded all my sermons up to the cloud, I'd have every sermon that I've ever preached available to me 24/7. I could access that 24/7. And that is true about you. You have access 24/7 to these witnesses telling you, keep going, you can make it, we've done it, so you can too. What we've been through is even harder than some of the things that you're facing, and we made it for the Lord. And so we can use about that modern idea of a cloud, but in the Bible, the cloud means something different. In the Bible, the cloud in the Old Testament, it was the presence. It was present, the cloud. Coming down, that presence of the Lord. We sometimes sing it in some of our songs at Holy Trinity. You probably sing them here. You know, your presence like a cloud. Come down upon us now. In the New Testament, the cloud picks up that idea, but also talks about the hiddenness. It hides. It hid Jesus from their sight. There's a hiddenness there. And so when we think about these witnesses, they can't see you and you can't see them right now, except with the eyes of faith. They can't see you, you can't see them, because it's a cloud. But it is the presence all around us of that witness to Jesus. And by you coming to church, by you coming to a men's breakfast, you're surrounding yourself by that witness to Jesus that says, keep going, don't give up. You will make it. God does have a plan for your life, and he wants you to discover it. Let's see what the next bit says. Is that making sense? What is it? What is it that hinders us so much that we need to throw it off, get rid of it? If you've ever heard maybe a sermon on this, you've probably heard people talk about running the race in the Roman times, you know, and Paul talks about running, the Apostle Paul talks about running the race. He's thinking about the Roman games. And when they ran, what did they run? They ran naked. They did. They wore no clothes because there was no Adidas, lightweight clothing to help you in that. Nike was the Roman goddess of victory. So no Adidas, no Nike, you got rid of all your clothes because you didn't want anything that would hold you back from winning that race. And the book of Hebrews says to us, throw off everything that hinders us. It's not talking about sin yet. It comes on to sin. It's talking about those things that in and of themselves, there's nothing wrong with them. They're perfectly okay. They're perfectly good. But when you sit here and you ask the Holy Spirit, is this helping me follow Jesus? Is this helping me in my life? They're not helping you. Sometimes the good can be the enemy of the best that God has for you. Amen? I love cars. Okay, I love cars. I'm sorry. It makes me very boring. And but who loves cars? Yeah. I love cars. I mean, honestly, I can go online and I can research buying a car, even though I have no money to buy that car. But I can go online and go on the configurator and configure the spec of that car up exactly the way I want that car. I can lose myself for hours just specking this car up. I love doing that. My friends come to me. Sometimes as a positive, I've got friends who come to me and ask me, Ian, I need to buy a car. What car should I buy? I try and not tell my church this, but anyways. Some of them are getting to know that, and they start asking me, what car should I buy? And we'll talk about the Lord. We'll talk about the Lord. I can lose myself. And there's nothing wrong with that in and of itself. It's perfectly okay, and it's enjoyable. But there are moments where I'm like, wait a minute. Why am I losing hours to this? This is not helping me run the race for Jesus. It's not that it's wrong in itself, but it would be just better. I've just got sometimes just throw it off. It's not that it always has to be thrown off, because it can be something that is nice and good and helps you and it's fun. That's okay. Jesus is all right with that. But sometimes it's getting in the way and it's becoming a bigger thing than it should be in your life, and you need to just throw it off. Throw off those things that just so easily hinder you. Let's just take a moment. Just ask, Holy Spirit, is there something in my life, Lord, that I've justified, because it's okay, it's not a sin, it's not written about in the Bible, but it's just not really helping me right now. It's actually taking up too much of my time, and I want to devote myself to you because I want to run the race and I want to keep on track. Holy Spirit, speak. Speak to my heart. Speak with the still small voice. Speak with vision, with picture. Maybe there's a word that the Holy Spirit just wants to speak to you, just something that comes to mind. Maybe it's just popped into your mind. Don't assume it's just your mind. Maybe the Holy Spirit has just planted there, just as a reminder. It's not wrong. God's not mad with you. But it's become a bigger thing than it should be. Because you know in your heart, Jesus has captured that heart. And Jesus, I want you as the big thing. In Jesus' name, amen. Let us throw off those things that hinder us and the sin that so easily entangles. Who asked that? Somebody asked that question over here. Was it that sin? You know, how is it that sin so easily entangles? I remember when I was a youth worker 25 years ago, 30 years ago, as a youth worker, and we used to use always an illustration. And I still think it's powerful today. And we used to take thread, just some thread, and we'd just get a volunteer. And I'd get a volunteer to come out, and I would just take the piece of thread, and I'd just wrap it around their wrists, and then I'd say, break it. And of course, they'd just break it. It's just a piece of thread. And then I'd take another piece, and then I'd wrap two pieces round, and then I'd say, break it. And then try a bit harder, and they'd break it. And then I'd do it three times, and then four times. By the time you get to four times, can't break it. They can't break the thread. And isn't that how sin works in our lives? It's the trouble with sin is we like it. That's the trouble with it. It's not that we always think it's horrible. Too often we think we like it. And we're like, I don't want to like this. And as men, we allow things in our lives. And we kind of get away with it the first few times. And we say, well, it's okay, God forgives. But then it becomes a habit. Then it becomes a habit. And suddenly, you're held, you're bound, you're in chains. But the good news is, Jesus is the chain breaker. Jesus is the one who can just cut with his big scissors the cords of sin that bind us, and he can cut right through them. He can do that this morning. When we come and when we confess our sins, the promise of the Bible, when we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You can walk out of this place in full wedding regalia, the most beautiful you've ever looked, the most glorious you've ever looked, with Jesus shining from your face, because Jesus has dealt with your sin and you're living for him. Jesus breaks the cords. It says the sin that so easily entangles us. If I was doing a talk on this and did an illustration, I'd probably do it with the ankles. It's going to trip you up. Don't think you can get away with sin forever. Maybe you've got away with it up to now. But hear the word of the Lord. Turn from your sin. and turn to Jesus, for he will abundantly pardon. He loves you so, so much. He's not fed up with you. He's calling. He's calling to you. And the witnesses are calling to you, and they're saying, run the race. Run for Jesus. Where are we? Hebrews 12. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. We are to run. What does it mean to run with perseverance? Let me tell you about a man called Cliff Young. Anybody heard of Cliff Young? He's a very famous Australian. Amazing guy. When I heard this story, I was like, that's amazing. He's famous in Australia for this one thing. In 1983, he entered an ultra marathon. I've never even run a marathon. I don't know if anyone has here. I take my hat off for you if you could. I couldn't. I've got friends who are marathon runners. And you know, they say when you get to 17, 18 miles, they say you hit the wall. You know, you hit a wall, and you've got to, you know, I get to the wall after half a mile. That's my fitness level. But he was going to do an ultra marathon, which is 875 kilometers, 544 miles. And the only way you can run that race is, well, all the experts, all the scientists say you run for 18 hours, then you rest for 6 hours, then you run for, that's the optimum if you're going to win that race. But Cliff Young didn't know anything about the science. And Cliff Young turned up at the start line in 1983 with wellies on, wearing wellies. He was a sheep rustler and potato farmer. And he starts running this race from Sydney to Melbourne. And the difference with him is he doesn't stop. He doesn't sleep. He doesn't need to, because for years and years, he used to round up sheep on massive farms in Australia, and he wouldn't sleep for days. So he just keeps going. He just keeps running. He crosses the line 9 hours ahead of his nearest competitor, all professional runners. 9 hours ahead of them. Why? Because he kept going. Let me tell you about a second person. His name is Rob Barron. He's a member of my church. He is the oldest member of the church. He is 93 years old. He never misses a service, morning or evening. He missed a service, I think, for the first time in the 14 years I've been there the other week, because he had to take his wife, who has severe dementia, and he looks after her in the house. He missed his first service. And he'd missed the service, and one of our elders went to visit him, and he said, I'm so upset. I've missed the service. I feel I've missed out on what God has for me. 93. And we're like, it's okay to miss a service at 93. It's okay. You've got a sick wife to look after. Why are you upset about this? And this elder starts telling him that he is going out on the turning. You've heard of the turning? You go out with the gospel and you share, you know, God has what a wonderful plan for your life. And can I ask you a question? If you died tonight, do you know that you'd go to be with God in heaven? And we've been out in the streets in Wester Hales, and we've asked that question. We had 17 make that commitment on the street. We all said it wouldn't work. How could it work? It's impossible unless God did it, because the method is useless unless God, by His Spirit, blesses it, and God blessed it. Rob, 93, says to this elder who goes out, and he was going out on that Saturday, he says, I want to come. I want to come out on the turning. So he got another friend. And because he's 93, he said, well, we'll go along to the meeting and we'll just pray. And so this friend said, we'll go and pray in that room. He says, I'm not praying. I'm going out. So he goes out and he steps out. And as he's going, he trips. He's very frail. He trips and he falls. And they have to call an ambulance for him. And so they take him into the hospital. His wife's in the hospital as well. And he's in this ward. And he said, I so wanted to go out. So wanted to go out. 93. And then this nurse came up. Oh, what have you been doing? And so he starts telling this male nurse, I wanted to go out on the streets and tell people about Jesus. I wanted to tell them about his love. But I stepped out and I stumbled and fell, and now I'm here. And the male nurse said, I'm not following God right now, but I need to get right with God. Right there in the hospital. So he hadn't missed his chance. He went out in faith. God had given him the opportunity. Another nurse was listening on the other side of the ward. She said, I'm a Christian. I didn't even know this guy was even interested in anything to do with God. I'm going to take him to church tomorrow with me. And the guy went with her to church. You see, I want to be like that. I want to be at 93. I'm still going for Jesus. I'm still going to run the race. And even when I trip and fall, and even when I mess up, and even when things do not go right, God will still have things prepared for me. Because what is the promise? We are God's workmanship, Ephesians 2:10. We are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God has prepared in advance for you to do. Amen? So that means God has prepared that in advance. It says, let's run with perseverance, the race marked out for us. So here's the news. God has already marked the race out. God already has a plan. You don't have to make that plan. God has made that plan. Some people get very uncomfortable with that it's all marked out. But it's the truth of Scripture. David cried out, didn't he? King David, all the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. That's the reality. God has created those good works in advance for us, for you to do. He's got things. We don't get saved by good works, but we are saved for good works that God has prepared for you. How do you find out what that is? We'll do this lastly. At Holy Trinity, when I took over as senior pastor, we had a vision, and I didn't feel we were to change that vision, that God had given us a vision for the kingdom, the overflow of the kingdom of God in this community. But what I did change was what were the values that we were going to carry with us. I chose four that I felt God laid on my heart. Four values for everything that we do. If we do something new, we ask these four. Are these four values being fulfilled in doing this for the Lord? If we want to stop something, sometimes we say, is it fulfilling these four values? And maybe it's time to stop something. It's great that you're starting up the men's breakfast. I love men's breakfast. God can do amazing things as men come together in the name of Jesus Christ. And so these are the four values. When I first thought about it, I thought, Lord, I want three values, but God gave me four. And three's good. I wanted three because I love that verse in the Scripture, a three-corded strand is hard to break. We use it at weddings, don't we, quite often, and that God, if God's in the relationship, it says, it makes it firm. And so I want a three, but have you ever seen a Reliant Robin car? You ever seen one of those, the three-wheel cars? Have you seen them? You've probably seen them about this. It's got three wheels, which is fine, but they're not brilliant. Four wheels is better, okay? Four wheels is better. So these are the four, simple. It just spells the mnemonic able. God is able. You are able. This is it. Ask. Believe. Love. Enjoy. Ask. Believe. Love. Enjoy. Because if you want to find out God's will for your life, it starts with a big ask. Everyone who Jesus said had great faith in the Gospels. Everyone who Jesus said, I've not seen faith like this. They have great faith. Every single one of them all came to Jesus with a big ask. God bless you, Pastor. It's nice to see you, Christiana. The Lord be with you. It's a big ask. Ask, seek, knock. So when we're wanting to find out God's will, we're coming to God and say, God, give me a vision. Give me a picture. Give me a word from you that will guide me on the right path that is marked out for me. Give me a word from you. And all of God's lambs can hear the shepherd's voice. Every single one of you can hear, and we all hear in different ways, but you can hear from the Lord and ask and keep asking until God gives you a vision for your life, till God gives you a word for your life, and keep asking, keep seeking, keep knocking. And if God has spoken things over you and it's kind of just been laid there and the vision tarries, go back to a God of justice and say, God, this is what you said. ask. Great faith and running that race always starts with a big ask. Come to God. We, as a Church of Holy Trinity, we only move forward on our knees. That's how we move forward. We're on our knees before God, and we're crying out to him. In your life, get on your knees before God, even if you've got weak knees, and say, Lord, I'm asking that you give me that vision. The second one was believe. Believe that God really does have a plan for your life and that you are not a special exception. You're not an exception. Don't let the devil get in and the devil's going, yeah, yeah, God has a plan for all their lives in church, but you have been left out of that plan. That's a lie from the enemy. God has a plan for you. God says, I know the plans I have for you. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future so that you can run the race marked out for you. Believe, God, you have a plan for me. And I'm not going to lose sight of that. I'm going to keep running the race of faith and believe you do have. Even when things are going wrong, even when I made wrong decisions, even when things go wrong like it did for Rob, God's able, even when we go off track, to bring us onto track again. He's got infinite possibilities. He doesn't get worried when we, oh, Ian has just, he's done that. He's messed up all my plans. He's bigger than that. He's in charge. He's in control. Ask, believe. And then the third one, love. Love the one in front of you. This is one of our just key values, that how can we know we love God unless we love the person God has just placed in our place right now? Usually the person God's placed there is not easy. They're not always the easiest person to love, but that's the test of love. Anyone, you don't have to be a Christian to love those who love you. I believe you have to be a Christian to love those who hate you or persecute you or drain your time or exhaust you. Love the one who is in front of you. And here's the great thing. Supposing you never felt you were fully in the will of God. You never felt you knew it all. You never felt it was all right. And you always felt, am I right? You were always feeling like that. Let me tell you, if you are loving the one that is placed in front of you, you will fulfill the law of Christ, who said, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself, as you love yourself. Love. When we love, it's amazing. When we're just willing to love, that's where the opportunities come. That's where the doors open up. When I was, I'm debating whether to share this because I don't want to, but you know, for 5 years, I moved all the chairs. We had to set up our church when I was in university. I moved all the chairs and put them away every single week for nearly 5 years, except during the holidays when I would go home to my parents. But I would do that every single week. And I can remember, and sometimes I was like, oh, why is nobody helping me in this? And I used to get hit. But I really felt God had said I was to do this and all that. And I just remember the minister, while I was doing clearing this one day, years into doing this, and he comes alongside me and he said, Ian, I want to give you these forms. I think you should apply for the ministry. I think you should apply for ministry in the Church of Scotland. He said, I don't usually do that. I was young. I was 21, 22, and I was like, not me. But in the place of loving service, that's where God creates the opportunities, opens the doors to the plans and purposes he has for you. You won't find the plans and purposes by just simply saying, well, God, let me be the pastor over a church of 10,000. You won't find the purpose of God. You find it in loving service, and then God starts to grow things. And when you're faithful in the few things, God will put you in charge of many, many things. Ask, believe, love, final, enjoy. This is what's drilled into me from first days of going to church. We were told, you're told this in Scotland, it's from something called the Westminster Confession of Faith. It's a very old confession of faith. You've probably heard of it. but starts like this. It just asks questions and then answers them. And the first question is, what is man's chief end? What is the chief purpose of man? What is God's purpose for you? And it says the chief end of man is to glorify God and to enjoy him forever. You know that? To glorify God and to enjoy him forever. Not endure him. Oh, I've just got to get this. But I'm here to enjoy the presence of God like a cloud. I'm here to enjoy actually walking. God has not created you so you spend all your time going, oh, am I in God's will? God has created you to enjoy his presence. And as you ask and believe and love, God will just fling wide open doors. And when those doors open, just run through them, even though they feel terrifying, even though it feels like jumping out of an aeroplane and there's a massive drop and that, jump out. As soon as the door opens, don't wait, just walk through those doors. God has a plan for you. Therefore, since, let's just, you've got it on your table, see if you can see a copy. Let's just read it together, just those verses, verse 12, just so we get it in our mind, because they're so important to this idea of keeping on track with the Lord, of keeping going. Let's read it together. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy set before him, endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. We only got on verse 1, but time is going. Let's just pray for a moment, and then I'll just open it up if you have any questions. Father God, you're an awesome God. You're a God who makes plans, purposes. It was your plan to create the world. It was your plan from the foundation of the world to send a Redeemer, Jesus. In your plan, you knew that we were going to mess up. We weren't going to get it right. But in your plan, you planned to redeem a people for yourself, children of God, not only made in your image, but part of your family for all eternity. We thank you, Lord, for the race that is marked out for us. We thank you for faithful men and women, maybe parents, youth leaders, ministers, brothers and sisters in Christ who witness to us and are in glory now, and they witness to us even today. They are crying out to us, keep going, we made it, you can too. Father, may we hear that word of encouragement that addresses us as sons. Do not give up. Keep on keeping on. The Lord is with you. He is mighty to save. Father, we come. Would you instill in us that need to come before you daily in asking faith, to come believing you really do have a plan and a purpose for us, and that the enemy will not steal that away from us by those things that hinder us and the sin that so easily entangles. Help us to love one another. May love spring up in this church here. May love spring up so much that everyone in the new flats all around would sense that love. They'd pick up on that love. They'd pick up on that joy, and they'd say, I want to be part of that. I'm going to walk through that door. I'm going to see what's happening there. Father, bring your kingdom growth in this place, Lord. Throughout Wester Hales, Lord, wherever our prayers between Holy Trinity and the Redeemed Church of God, wherever our prayers have come into agreement over this community, Lord, answer that prayer from heaven. Come with Holy Spirit revival in this place. Transform hearts and minds. Turn the hearts of the children back to their fathers and their fathers to the children. Restore relationships. Create good business within that creates good jobs and lasting employment, Lord. Bring down crime in this place, that there won't even need to be a police station in the middle of this community, Lord. Bring beauty to this community, Lord, that we might see art and attractive buildings and grassy areas and places where children can play safely without fear of harm. bring down those who would want to come and bring evil into this community, destroy them in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and bring your life here, Lord, because it's your life that we want, your purpose that we want. We want your plan, Lord. What is your plan for Wester Hales, Lord? We believe, Lord, that you have many people here, that there are people, Lord, that you are longing to come to you, and we long to see them come to you in saving faith, transforming faith. Lord, come and visit us in a day of your power. Come and do a work that we, humanly speaking, cannot do, but can partner with you, that only you can do, converting hearts, changing lives, bringing revival that transforms the whole community. Come, Lord Jesus, we pray. Help us to join in. Help us to realize that Jesus, by his Spirit, he's running alongside us. Won't leave us alone. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. 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 Amen.
Wow. Wonderful. And that will give us a time to ask questions. But some things I took note of, again, I don't know where you are on your stage, but witnesses, we're surrounded by witnesses, so remember that you are here for a purpose. If you think you're going through difficult times, then there are people that have gone on before you. Throw off the things, just throw them off. How do you ensure you're on track? Throw off all those unnecessary things. The word encourages binge watching now of box sets. Throw them off. They're not necessarily seen, they're not bad, but throw them off sometimes. I like this one. It says, avoid sin and confess them. Avoid sin and confess them. That's the only way you can keep yourself on track, because it's little by little a tread. I like the analogy of a tread. When I go somewhere, I'll use that. Take a tread with me. I hope they can't break you on the fourth one. Amen. And it's persevere to the end. I heard that story of Cliff Young as well a few years ago, and it blew my mind. And the version of story I heard was someone that was actually there. The guy was there. He says when he was there standing, everyone looked at Cliff Young, and he was just like that. And we're like, what's wrong with him? His trainer was, I think, his father, his grandfather, and he was in the wheelchair, and that was the only person cheering, Cliffy. And they asked him later on, how did he manage? And that was it. And one of the other things they said, that he was a poor farmer and his dog had died. So he couldn't normally use, the dog goes around, helps barking. And he didn't have a dog and he couldn't afford to buy a dog. So he was running around and he was barking. So his lungs had so expanded that he just kept on doing it. And that's how he was able to run. And it's an amazing thing. You should go and read, if you can read the story, it blows your mind. It tells you that you can, a lot of things that we think are impossible, when we talk about being on track, you say, I can't do this anymore. It's because we have said we can't do it. Everything is possible with the right training. And finally, the able, ask. If you don't have a plan or if you are not clear on your plan, just ask. Keep asking. Don't stop asking. Be like Anna. I keep saying, my God, did she give me the woman that was in the Bible that said came to the king, and the king said, I don't believe in God. That woman just came reincarnated in Anna. That girl will pester you. She pestered me for £2 since February. This week, I had to, you know what? Just take your £2 since February every single day. Daddy, you owe me £2. And then she would bring up a different way. Daddy, I think you owe me £2. I said, but anyway, ask. God wants us to be like that. Ask. Believe. Sometimes we don't believe because we think it's either the plan is too big for us, or it's even too small. I love your example about cleaning the chairs after service. We probably will be thinking to ourselves now, a lot of us say, well, now you know that thing you are doing, God is seeing it. So no matter how big or small, believe. Then love. Love what you are doing. Love service. Love the service you are doing. Don't think that what you're doing is too small. Just love it, and then enjoy your enjoy his presence in what you're doing. Absolutely amazing. With all these things to put together, if you keep on these things, you will definitely ensure that you're on track. And I pray that the Lord will help us in Jesus' name. Do we have any questions for Ian? Just to probably share this one. Is he on? Any questions, please feel free to ask. This is question time, and hopefully Ian can answer the questions. Do you have a question?
Just to get us started, can God have more than one plan for someone? Is it possible? Or is there always just one major plan? Can God have more than one plan for a person? Thank you.
This is a question that theologians have battled with, I think, all down through the centuries. And I think you can pretty safely say that there's been a big division in Christianity believing that. I'll share a little bit of what I think the Lord's shown me. This is that God has his eternal heavenly plan, and that will always come to pass. No matter what we do, we can't change that overall plan of bringing people to salvation in Jesus Christ. And God is at work doing his plans. And we think we're doing our plans and that. But God's overall plan will always work. It's a bit like I grew up on an island in the Isle of Lewis. And you had to go on a ferry. And you got on the ferry. And on that ferry, you can do lots of things. You can go to the bar, you can go to the playroom, you can go to the lounge, you can go to the restaurant, you can do all these kind of things, but it won't affect the destination. You'll still get to exactly the same destination. So God's plan will always win out. But we pray a prayer, the Lord's Prayer, and I hope you say the Lord's Prayer together as a church, because I really think not because it's you repeat it, you know, it's like by rote, but that in it we have like a kingdom manifesto from Jesus. And I want everyone in church to know that inside out. I want them to know that kingdom manifesto. And what is the prayer we pray? That your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And that tells me that Jesus taught that God's will is not done in every individual situation, because I have to pray, your will be done on earth. In heaven, God's will is always done. It is perfectly done. That's why there's no sickness in heaven, and there's no sin in heaven, no darkness in heaven, because God's will is perfectly done in heaven. Nothing unrighteous or dark will be allowed there and is not allowed there. And if anything did appear there, like Satan gets, Lucifer gets cast out of heaven because there's pride found and there's nothing evil. But on earth, men do evil things, women do evil things, and God calls them what they are evil. God is never the author of evil, he's never the author of sin. And so we're praying, your will be done. And in the midst of that, we're saying there are things where God's will is not done, but we want that heavenly will to come down into Wester Hills, don't we? We want that heavenly, I want that in my life. There's things that I've done in my life that I've gone to the Lord in forgiveness for, and now I'm praying, Lord, your will. But I'm praying, Lord, that I haven't damaged things, because this is the way I think of it. I've damaged things so much that your will won't take place. But this is the thing, it's never too late. Cry out to the Lord, your will be done in my life. Does that answer your question? Yeah. So yeah, is there one plan? There is one overall plan, overarching plan, the glory of Jesus. That is one overarching plan. But in your life, it is being worked out in a million different ways, and God can keep track of every single one of them without a moment's thought, and he's got all eternity to sort it out. All eternity to sort it out. Time is not an issue for God. It's an issue for us. It's not an issue for God. Yeah.
I'm reminded of a scene in a movie that I saw recently, and this is the Avengers Infinity Wars.
Any good?
It was good, yeah. And there's the Infinity Wars is the old one, not the Endgame. There was a scene there of a guy called Doctor Strange. And the iron man looked at him and asked him, "What is wrong with you?" And he said, "He has just looked into the future." And he said, "What did you see?" And for me, when I was watching that part, I had to watch it again because it just reminded me of how we are with God. And he said, "I saw 40 million scenarios." And he says, "How many did you win?" "One." And he said, "Is this the one?" He said, "No." Now, does God have two plans for us? There's only one plan, as Ian said. You might go 14,600,000 and ways. In the end, you will get to that plan. Because his plan is his plan. This is why Jesus said that the day he's coming back, nobody knows. Because you know what? God will keep extending the time until his plan is perfected. So Jesus might come tomorrow. Jesus might not come for another 10,000 years. Your mistakes would ultimately walk his way back onto that ultimate plan, like he did for Joseph. Joseph said, "Listen, you guys, your plan was to destroy me, but God meant it for good." Could Joseph have gone to Egypt in a different way? Absolutely. He didn't need to go the way he went. I strongly believe that famine, the dream would have happened. They would have heard, "Oh, there's a guy in Israel interpreting dreams." Pharaoh would have sent for that guy. He would have come as a dignitary from his own and interpreted the dream. And the Pharaoh said, "You know what? You are not going back. You are staying here." It could have happened that way. But the brothers' plan, they tried to change the plan of God, but ultimately his plan. So yes, we might have different routes, but ultimately God's plan comes to pass. Any other question? Yes, sir.
I suppose God again helps us as it leaves clues in our lives through all the experiences and the abilities that he has given us. It would be very strange for God to want you to do something that you don't want to do or you don't have a clue about or you are not just inclined to. It would be very strange, you know, because again, we've lent ourselves to so many things. We've developed ourselves in different areas. We've built up a lot of experiences in certain areas. And I suppose most of these things are clues into where God is leading us. Some people have described this, your shape. Your S stands for your spiritual abilities, H for your heart, H for your abilities. I can't remember them now. Your experiences is the E. So all of these things as we grow up together, even the unfortunate experiences, they're part of the things that helps us on this journey. And it just shapes us into what God wants us to do. So the clues are always there. We just need to, again, embrace them, look at them, acknowledge them. And
can I just pick up on that just as we end? Because that's a very good point to make, and I had thought about going into that type of thing about who we are, and that. And so, just one thing I just want to say, just to leave you with, because of something I was taught when I was a teenager, somebody came to me, and I'd preached my first sermon, 17, and preached my first sermon, and I heard a speaker very soon after that saying, "If you can do anything else." Do that. Don't be a preacher, right? If you can do anything, this is what you sort of preach, and he gave the impression that you can only be a minister in the church, if you really didn't want to, if it was you were really going to be forced against your will. And that was the kind of picture I carried around for a long time. And it was such a twisted picture, as if God is only going to call you to that which you definitely don't want to do. And so I kind of had this view that God's going to call me as a missionary to Outer Mongolia or something, like somewhere I definitely didn't want to. You know, what a twisted view of God we sometimes get. That actually God knows. He says, "I will direct you along the right plan for your life. I will show you the way you should go," Psalm 32, 8 and 9. And then it says, "Do not be like the horse or mule that has no understanding. You know, do you know the old versions that the King James Version said? Don't be a dumbass. That's what it says. That's what it says. A dumbass. Don't be a dumbass. That's what it literally. So don't be like where you're like waiting for God to drag you kicking and screaming into what you don't want to do. That's not my experience of the Lord Jesus, that he births desires within your heart. He deserts, he births passions within your heart. And I said, Lord, I hate public speaking, but I want to preach the good news of Jesus Christ. And God took that passion and that desire, and he took someone who hated and still does not like public speaking. I don't look for public speaking. It's not my natural. I much prefer to be in the crowd. I much prefer to listen. But there was a passion there to share God's word. It burned within my heart. And what burns within your heart and your passions, God will take that and use that to his glory. Amen. Amen. Amen.
And then let's give ourselves a round of applause for being here this morning. Thank you once again for coming. Before we go, let's just bow our heads and pray. You can never have too much of prayer. Let's pray for what we prayed this morning. I know Ian prayed for us about the Holy Spirit to speak to our heart. Let's pray that we will listen and that we will hear. Let's pray that the grace to ask, even when we don't understand. One of the twisted views we have of God is that you don't bother him with questions. So we tend to think, well, maybe I should know that. I've been a Christian long enough. I shouldn't be asking such a silly question, or supposedly silly question. Pray for the grace to be able to ask when you're uncomfortable. Let's pray for the grace to believe. Believe when the plan seems small beneath you, because that's the Bible says we should not despise the days of humble beginnings. That might be where he wants to start you off from. And believe when it's big, much bigger than you are currently, because again, he has great plans for us. Let's pray for the grace to love one another, to love service, to love the lost souls. Jesus came. He said, I give my life. No one takes it from me, but I give it willingly because he loved the lost. He said, I came to seek and to save the lost. And let's pray for the grace to enjoy this journey. A lot of us worry about tomorrow. Oh, this plan. I'm able to achieve it. Enjoy the journey. Enjoy each day. Enjoy each day. So that when you get to this destination, you have a story to tell. It won't be a case of, wow, actually, I didn't even know when time passed. Because you didn't actually do anything. You just enjoy the time. So enjoy the journey. Enjoy his presence. And let's pray for our brethren who are not here, those who could not make it for one reason or another, that the Lord would touch them. That our lives will not remain the same. We are in Wester Hills for a reason. I like the prayer Ian prayed about businesses, about changing and transforming the area. I believe that the church can rise up and do the things of old. A lot of things that we see now, a lot of policies that we see, principles started off in the church. My brother and I were having a discussion. The football matches that we watch, the Premiership, all started from the church. The church organizes football games to take boys off the street to avoid them joining gangs, being hooligans. The church can do much more again. But you and I need to be there to fund this kind of project without going to the council, without going to people. And our God is able to do it. So let's pray that the Lord will use us in West Hill, because we are part of God's plan right now in this place for as long as you're here. You might not be here forever, but whilst you're here, you are part of God's plan. So let's pray for that. Thank you, Lord, for answered prayers. And we pray for the rest of the weekend. Let's pray for our services tomorrow, that everywhere the name of God will be called upon, that he will be there, present, to fellowship with them, to speak to them, to touch their hearts. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Daddy. For in Jesus' name we are free. Amen. Amen. Let's share the grace together as we close. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely, goodness. going to say we'll recite the Lord's Prayer together.
Yeah.
Is everyone comfortable with that?
Yeah.
So let's rise to our feet after we recite the Lord's Prayer.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. Some people use the King James, some people use the New King James. Yes. Wonderful.
It
doesn't matter. Thank you very much for coming. Please, there's breakfast. It cannot go to waste. Can we please help yourself?
You are great, yes, you are holy one. Walked upon the sea, raised the dead. Reign in majesty, mighty God. Everything routine about you is great. You are great, yes, you are holy one. Walked upon the sea, raised the dead. You reign in majesty, mighty God. Everything routine about you is great. You are great.
You are great.
You are great.
You are great.
Say you are great.